Welcome back to Tamano Perspective. We're joined now in the studio by Professor Miriam Ferrer, member of the Government Peace Panel, retired General Danny Lim, who's now a Customs Deputy Commissioner for Intelligence, and acting Army Spokesman Major Harold Cabuno. Good evening to all of you.
Good evening. Good evening.
And thank you for coming. I mean, this is such a hot topic, and we would like to get your ideas and perspectives on this. For you first, Miriam, there were two bombings in Zamboanga yesterday, and I think a third bomb was found today. Mm-hmm. Have you asked if the MILF is involved in this?
You know, again, it's very hard to speculate without any other information. I read the news, but the news is very bare, so it's hard to speculate now what the reasons for this or who are responsible for this.
Yeah, but Miriam, isn't the idea of having that peace panel to have that flow of communication, meaning that if there is an issue, because it's not something out of the blue.
Yeah.
I mean, there seems to be some kind of either pattern or connection. Shouldn't you be able to say, are you guys connected with this or not?
Well, we only, it's again, you know, we do have to be very careful about this. Maybe it's logical to think that, okay, there are these bombings going on, maybe it's intended to defuse some of the, you know, the pursuit operations that are concentrated in some areas, like Zamboanga, Sibugay. So maybe that's a speculation. Maybe it has some logic in it, but you need hard facts
Are you not ready? Sorry, I have to keep harping on this.
Yeah.
Are you not ready to ask them at least? Because the sentiment of many people is that you've been too easy on the MILF.
Uh-huh.
So how do you respond to that? Like, if you can't even ask them a simple question like this, how are you going to make them commit to other more, let's say, onerous or difficult stuff?
So when there are incidents like this, the first group that works on it will be the ceasefire committee, because they're there. They're in Mindanao.
Okay.
So we do have a ceasefire committee, and they have open lines with their counterparts in the MILF. So as of now, we have not received any report.
And you have not asked them yet?
No, I'm sure they're asking this.
Okay.
Because it's something that, you know, you have to add up all the things that are taking place, and you have to be sort of one step in advance. So we do need that kind of very good intelligence to be able to see what could possibly, you know, potential conflict points in the next few days.
But okay, you said conflict points. How have these events affected the viability of the peace process?
I think we saw the president sticking his neck out.
Okay.
To continue with the peace process despite, you know, this very, a sentiment for revenge against the unfortunate tragedy that happened in Basilan. And the situation really means that we do have to control. Nobody will, you know, benefit if these things get out of hand, if the violence actually spreads out in different areas. Then it's going to be, like, more unmanageable. And that's what we're trying to prevent.
Yeah, of course. Yes. Definitely, I agree with you, especially someone who has roots in Mindanao. I'll ask you another question. You can all jump in. The MILF has admitted that they don't really have full control, even in their areas, that there are lawless elements. So the question arises, Miriam, why are we even talking to them? If, in truth, they do not have full control, even of their own forces, why is the government spending so much time and money to talk to the MILF when perhaps they're not the only group that we should be speaking to?
Well, we realize that, and that's why the president's instruction was really to make sure that this process is inclusive. So while we do have these bilateral tables going on, specifically between the government and the MILF, and we're still finishing the process, the implementation with the MNLF, it's very clear that as far as we're concerned, this peace process is not for any specific group. It's for the whole people who are affected in this area.
Okay. How about you, Danny? You know, you've been a rebel also. I'll ask you first, what do you think will it take to get the MILF to start negotiating with the government with full, you know, being full transparency and full
going
honesty?
Going back to the previous question, I think it's very clear
that
the ball is on the court of the MILF.
All right.
They have to prove that indeed they can account, they can be responsible for the actions of their members.
Yes.
We have to exact accountability here. We cannot be forever be engaged in talks while stabbings are being done at the back. So they have to show. They have to show proof of sincerity and accountability, and that they are able to control their members.
Okay, Danny, you have your ear to the ground. You're in intelligence, and of course, you were part of that part of the military that wanted reforms. How are our soldiers on the ground reacting to all of this, to this all-out justice initiative by Malacañang?
We cannot deny that the morale of the members of the men in uniform is affected.
Okay.
But they should not be seduced into falling into the siren call of a destabilization. It's understandable that certain sectors, certain people who are detractors of this administration, who would want nothing to see but the failure of this administration to steer or agitate these soldiers into engaging into something else.
Okay, you made a statement earlier that you believe that the allies of Arroyo are in fact involved in this destab moves, and of course their spokesman has contradicted this. Do you stand by your statement?
Well, it's logical to think that people who are getting hurt by the anti-corruption program, by the reforms being done by this administration, would be behind these initiatives to seduce our soldiers into engaging into destabilization acts.
Okay. I have another question, Danny, before I go to Harold. When this animal called Area of Temporary Stay suddenly became part of the framework in dealing with the MILF, what was the reaction of the soldiers? Because, of course, for other people, they're thinking, this is our country, this is our national territory. Why should we say that there are certain areas that we can't even control?
Yes, I think there are so many calls, siren calls for all-out war.
Okay.
And convincing our soldiers that our president is not very supportive of our soldiers because he wouldn't declare an all-out war.
Yes.
I believe that he did the right pronouncement decision to continue with the peace process. What we don't need is an all-out war.
So what's the alternative?
The alternative is to just implement the law.
Okay.
Just implement the legal processes. We want to seek justice for the victims of these crimes, then do it legally. There are areas where our soldiers, our agents of government can't enter, then why can't we do that? There are people, simply too many people and too many groups who hold the firearms not allowed by the law.
Okay.
Then we should address all of this, and the bottom line and the end result of all of this is what we want to see. Implement justice, this would tantamount to an all-out war.
Okay, Harold, I have to ask you this question. The investigation into the Albarca incident revealed that certain procedures weren't followed. Is that correct to say that certain procedures were not followed, and this is part of the reason why our soldiers were killed?
The investigation is still ongoing, and I was told that according to the AFP Inspector General,
okay,
this will be out by this weekend. So we'll just have to wait until it is out, and it will be revealed to the public.
Okay, so set aside, I understand, it's going to come out this weekend. But how about that point that our soldiers were outside the area of temporary stay? Is that something that is being questioned at all? Or we do, the military is very clear that they were four kilometers away from the ATS area.
Yes, so we have this global positioning system. We were very sure that we were indeed out, and it is in Barangay Candog, which is true. It is about 4 kilometers away from this so-called ATS.
Okay, so the position of the military was that it was going after known criminals and hence doing an authorized military operation. Is that correct?
Yes, right. It was against the group of Long Malat.
Okay.
And it so happened that these MILF rebels, they reinforced the group of Malat, leading to this tragic incident.
Okay, well, yeah. This is, I think, the real issue here, Miriam.
Yeah.
And I think it's also one of the reasons why Senator Cheese has asked, in not so many words, that the peace panel resign. There is this perception that the peace panel is tying the hands of the military.
Just to
flesh it out, if you follow the procedure in the agreement with the MILF, before the soldiers can go to an area near the ATS, they have to inform, right?
They have to coordinate.
They have to coordinate.
They don't have to ask permission, which is sort of the framing, but they do have to coordinate. They're saying that we have this law enforcement mission,
yes,
and don't hit us. So
yes,
if indeed they did coordinate, as some of the reports are saying, but we're not sure because that's a subject of investigation, then there's really that kind of treachery involved.
Yeah,
and that's what
that's
we have
problem,
to find out.
Miriam, if you take a look at the website of the MILF, luaran.com.
Yeah, I read it every day.
did you read it? They said that because of A1 military intelligence from their spy,
right,
that they were able to ambush, or not, they used the word defend. Doesn't that seem, because they got that information that soldiers
right
were coming, didn't they use that as the basis to overwhelm these soldiers? So don't you think that your rules of engagement, I don't know if I'm using the correct term, don't you think that they have to be restudied? Please step in, gentlemen, because it seems to be putting our soldiers into really a strange situation.
Actually, it's supposed to protect them. If the rules are observed and the ceasefire agreement and the guidelines that go with it are actually observed, then it actually protects them from this kind of, call it, you know, treachery, or it actually protects them from the situation from getting out of hand or actually being attacked by the MILF. Now, the question is, was there a violation of the agreement? And then if there is, then that's where the accountability really has to be exacted.
And what are do you have any comments, Daniel, on this?
Yes, there are implementing rules for the cessation of hostilities, and both sides are committed to that. This underscores the need for a really objective investigation, less the emotionalism, to get into the bottom of these things, where there indeed violations of the implementing rules of the cessation of hostilities by which side or by both sides.
But isn't the problem something about the fact that you don't know who the MILF is, okay? For example, the people that they were running after in Al Barka, some say MILF, some say not part of the MILF. When there is this perception that when it's convenient for the MILF, they will say they're part of our group. But when it's not convenient, they'll say, no, they're a breakaway group. So doesn't that make it difficult for the military on the ground to conduct these operations? Because there's always that issue that, are they part of the MILF or not? Gentlemen, would you like
in the case of Long Malat and this Haji Laksawasnawi, Haji Dan Laksawasnawi, we have pictures of him.
Okay.
He was arrested by the PNP back in 2009, so we have these mug photos of him.
Okay.
And we were very sure that his identity, we have this picture distributed to the soldiers.
Okay.
But as regards to his followers, we cannot really be sure, because that's the problem, they don't have these identification cards as compared to the soldiers.
Okay, one last question about the bounty. They're removing that bounty. What is the effect on our soldiers? Because I think it's a negative, it's a very negative message. It's like saying that our soldiers are doing their job because of a bounty.
That is not true. And I don't hear anything about this bounty. It's usually received by a civilian tipster as part of the procedure. And there are documentations that will prove that these are received by this civilian informant. There is
so
a process.
Our soldiers are doing their job not because of any bounty.
No.
Okay. On that note, thank you, Harold, Danny, and Miriam.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Stay tuned for more Tamano Perspective.